So Daniel, it's up to you.
Thank you, Laurent. So I want to thank you and Olivia to be at the origin of all this project that we study purpose with artificial neural networks. Okay. I want to thank my collaborators, Claude. Okay. And also another source of my interest for Topos, okay, coming after this work about information that I will speak a bit, is with Alain Berthoz, so in neuroscience, okay, by trying to find kind of internal geometry in the brain. Okay, and we propose that they are organized, okay, like a stack. Okay? So we hope there is also application to natural neural network, okay? Not only artificial. Other acknowledgement are written, okay, in this text. So it's not a good reference. It was yesterday, and Jean-Claude give us the good reference to this paper, which contains all what I will explain, plus the details. Yeah. So the first goal was to find a frame for a deep neural network, the DNN. And Jean-Claude has explained well. Yeah. So I will skip some slide, okay, because they were already presented by Jean-Claude, okay, so to focus on the different topic, which is, in some sense, how we call include also in this framework, okay, of Topos and HAL, okay, the possibility to combine moduli in network, okay, and to make that networks could speak each with one other. Okay. So we saw that we suggest a category with the quaternic topology, by adding this four, okay. So I don't remember the construction. I don't remind you the construction, but in fact, I want to add something. I will work mostly in another setting, because what matters in the topos, and as Olivia explained us a lot of time, okay, and convincingly, in fact, we could choose different sites for that. Okay. And in this finite case, okay, of a site without endomorphism, in fact, we can throw out all the topology. And it was remarked by Joel Friedman some years ago, and it depends on the Caramello theorem, okay, which say necessary and sufficient condition for a topos to be a topos of pre-shift over category. And here we have such a pre-shift. The category of pre-shift over the poset, in fact. And I don't want to explain in detail, okay, all the structure, but perhaps we look at this kind of example. Okay. Our better one, perhaps, is this one. Yeah. So it is a representation of the graph of the cell, which are named LSTM, and I come back at the end of the talk, because in some sense they play a very interesting role. Okay. To have a semantic content, okay? And we try to understand why. Okay? Why, for example, not only for the extension of gradient, okay, but they continue to be used now 30 years after the invention, okay, in networks. Each time, for example, you have to translate the text. Okay? So it's known that networks, okay, mainly detect statistical property of the text, okay, but in some sense, it says that also this kind of cell has some at least syntactic level, if not semantic. And so you see the graph, ordinary graph to the left. Okay? And now I write the poset, yeah, on the right. Okay? And you see what are added in the same sense, okay, is this red arrows, okay, and which makes that this point, okay, which look like attractors. Okay? Correspond to the fork better. Okay. So in the same sense, you have two kinds of input. You have the input, which comes, for example, xt here is data coming at time t. Xt plus one, data, new data coming at time t plus one. You see the arrow are in the reverse direction as an information flow. because we look at a contravariant functor, okay, and for many good reasons. Okay. But here, the finite setting is not so much wrong. You see that in some sense, this internal part here, okay, are also sending information. Okay. And that's the lesson. Dynamically, they will be neutral in ordinary neural network. Okay. But in the future, okay, we can expect that some kind of spontaneous activity can come from this point here, okay, because they are similar to the input. Okay. And after that, you have an output for this network two. And the output is here, for example, in HT. Okay. It's output of all the cell. It's a memory for the future. CT also, okay, is part of the memory for the future. It starts here, and it starts and goes away. Okay. And so we work in some sense with pre-shifts. Okay. And the activity is represented by the pre-shift dynamic. Okay. And the weights are also represented by the pre-shift. Okay. And they are in some sense dual with each other because the pre-shift X transmits information. Okay. And the pre-shift W forgets weights. Forget the whites by passing to the next layer, which corresponds well to what happened in the backpropagation learning. Okay. But then we just have to remember that we have transformed the graph to go to a perset, okay, and we have a dynamical object on this perset. In the topos of this process of pre-shift, okay. And one is a kind of fibered object, okay, over the weights. Okay. For each system of weights, okay, we have one dynamics. Okay. But this dynamic is not really as a usual dynamic because, in some sense, at this point, okay, the fork we have had. Okay, we have this kind of possibility to have spontaneous activity that at this moment we do not use. In some sense, the dynamic is given by the section. Okay. So in the section with the hypothesis we make, okay, are totally characterized by the data in input. As a state in the layers in input, okay, they determine the section. So what is the dynamic in this sense is section of a pre-shift. Okay. And here in the equation one, okay, you have the characterization, okay, of this pre-shift. But perhaps it's much too long to describe, and it was already described by Jean-Claude. Okay. And this equation two here, only the equation two, look at it. Okay. You say how is made the full dynamic. So you have the state x in index r, you have the weights, all the system of weights becoming in the network, okay, and you apply only part of these weights, okay, to the state, and at the same time you forget this part of the weight, okay, and you are only interested by the weight will come after. Okay. And here it's the detail, okay, that's not very, very interesting. You could look at the paper, okay, it's because it's a theorem one, okay, that the backpropagation it can be represented here, okay, as a flow of natural transformation of the object of whites. Okay. And of course, what is interesting in practice, okay, is more the lemma one, okay, which makes the success of this backpropagation algorithm, okay, because you have this explicit sigma pi formula, okay, to rise the gradient. Okay. And so it give an access, okay, to the gradient. After that, it's another matter, okay, of course, to integrate the gradient, because it's known that in most applications, okay, you have many, many local attractors, okay, is very non-convex function. And here it's a schematic view of the functioning. but we will take in mind. And what's this analogy? In some sense, we want to pursue that this is a kind of dynamical system with parameters, okay, which are given by the weights. Okay. And it's not only learning, which is important. In fact, the learning is really dependent on the data and the question at the output. Okay. And so this influence of input data and output, okay, will make that the weights will change, okay, depending on the kind of input and output you want. Okay. And you have certainly a kind of catastrophic study, okay, to perform, to understand how the dynamic depends to the why. For example, in the experiment that Jean-Claude presented us, okay, we saw something that really we don't expected, okay, that with two layers, for example, in a simple problem, you have kind of Fourier analysis. It's very spectacular, is that you have an approximation by harmonic of degree three of the shape of the formulas, because we were looking to formulas only. And at some moment, you have a bifurcation, okay, and you go to a new attractor, which makes logic. Okay. So in some sense, it says that all the structure of the bifurcation, yeah, and here is this representation of what I say about the dynamic, because the dynamic is done by bisection, which is the first level of the cohomology. Okay. And here, sigma denotes this bifurcation set, which has to be understood. Of course, at this moment, very few analytical results. For example, why you shift from Fourier to logic is certainly very hard from the analytical point of view. So the second goal was try to explain why DNN do better than approximation of function and interpolation. It was the subject of Jean-Claude aussi, too, because in many interesting cases, you have a restriction on the structure, on the functioning and the learning. Okay? And it comes from geometry or semantic, okay, which is extracted or expected from the input data and the problem that the network has to solve as output. Okay? And this is this internal structure that Jean-Claude discussed, okay, which is given now by not Prechet in some sense, but from the construction of Grothendieck of zero of vibration. Okay, it is given by a contravariant functor to some category, for example, the category of groupoid, okay, or the category of group. Okay. And this gives a stack. And the hypothesis is that the dynamical object and all the objects that we will present, okay, lift to this stack, okay, and become object of the topos over the stack. Okay. And we go in this sense to the classifying topos. And we join here, okay, the notion which is now studied extensively by Olivia of the relative topos. Okay. In some sense, it's another name for this situation, but she looked very carefully now at the logical interpretation in terms of, for example, first order or second order logic. Okay. And we started with that. Okay. So, before perhaps I show you, because we mentioned several times, okay, this kind of Fourier analysis made by the CNN. Okay. And here you have an idea of the architecture which are used today. And you see there are really no more chain of fully connected network. Okay. You have several parallel views which come together, okay, at some point. Okay. And you see in the first layer, okay, where after that it's very difficult to understand what happened, but in the first layer, you see this very nice wavelet kind of analysis or opponent analysis of color, which probably construct the three-dimensional space of basic colors. Okay. And here I present you, because it will be another reason to look at this invariant structure, is this way we use translation by this. Here you see the LSTM chain, okay, in the right and bottom. But what is original, okay, and this is the main term I will come at the end, okay, is this fact that we recent use of networks, okay, for example, starting in 2015 and now continuing, okay, and exploding, okay, is to use both language, okay, and image analysis with CNN, okay, to answer questions about scent. Okay. It's not only how to detect a cat, okay, which could be done by a simple DNN, but to combine many things and to try to have a description. And now people are able to have a dynamical description in time, okay, of what happened in movie, not only in image. Okay. And so this is pass or the expression, okay, of this internal structure, okay, which are very far from a fully connected network, which is used to prove the theorem of approximation. And so this is what I say. DNN that analyze image today, for instance, in object detection, have several channels of convolutional map, max pooling, fully connected maps that are joined together to take decision. It looks like, in some sense, a structure for localizing the translation invariance, as it happens in the successive visual area in the brains of animals. Okay? That you have, in some sense, many copies of translation for each image. This was discovered also by a neuroscientist, Hubel and Wiesel, for example, a long time ago, in the 50s. And experiment shows that in the first layer, in the wavelets are formed to translate contracted and so on. But after that, you develop certainly more and more invariants, okay, by using not only architecture, but experiments. Okay. Other Lie groups were used. And now I come to this presentation of the stack. It is given by contravariant functor from the process C of the DNN to the category of categories, for example. And the vibration is reconstructed by this Gropendieck construction or Giro construction, okay, which is described by the formula beyond how you construct the morphisms, okay, in the category F, okay, which are given by the functor, contravariant functor S. Okay. And now it's the interest also of Olivia and Jean-Claude Manson that. Okay. So the pressure for F, the elements of the classifying topos, okay, are also described by local pressures, okay, in each fiber, which are related by natural transformation. And among this natural transformation, okay, you have a very important one, okay, which are the two adjoint, okay, of the F star. And this F alpha, okay, is the map from one category for one layer in the category associated to the layer just before the dynamic point of view. And just the composition with alpha gives you from the topos in the fiber to the topos in the fiber, okay, and more functor. Okay. And this functor has two adjoints, okay, one left adjoint, one right adjoint. Okay. And from the left adjoint, okay, with the exclamation, you know in English what it is, okay, you have a map, okay, which goes from the classifying object in what is here, the fiber before, to the next the fiber more closer to the output, okay? Come back by the pullback. And this define an object, okay? And this object of the classifying purpose, okay? With some kind of integration, okay, that's, which is written as a derivation by Grothendieck, is the way you construct the logic from the local logic, okay, the logic in each fiber. That's a very important point for all I want to explain. This is not sufficient in general to transport the theory. Because in some sense, the moral of the semantic functioning that we expect, because here in some sense, we are describing the structure, which we expect that the dynamic can learn, okay, that it is some kind of constraint we give. For example, in CNN, we impose that the maps from states to other states are given by convolution matrix, okay, but with non-linearity added. Okay. But this is in some sense a hope that the real network understands it. Okay. But this hope cannot be satisfied if at the theoretical level, you cannot transfer the question from the output inside the network and the theories coming by the network working in the layers, okay, to the output, that the plan that he helped to answer. So in this case, in some sense, there are two things which are important, probably not necessary, but sufficient, is that the two morphisms, which are here the pullback, okay, and its height adjoint, okay, which is more difficult to describe because it's already some kind of cohomology, okay, are both geometric and open. Okay. And for that, we could follow Olivia or also MacLean and Murdy, and to extract this necessary sufficient condition to have a good function, theoretical function. So, following Giraud in his paper, we see that is the case in some sense is F alpha are themselves vibration. So, in some sense, the good stack. Not only vibration over the site, the seat, okay, which is here, we forget the topology because we look at pressure, okay, and but also internally, okay, you must have some vibration. And what it says is something that people thought in statistical terms through what is named the bottleneck hypothesis, is that in some sense you lose progressively information from the input data. Okay, to be closer and closer to the simple question which are asked as the output. Okay. So in the sense that this map says that you have a kind of operation of forgetting the details, okay, to construct something more significant. And the lemma which expresses that is that you say, well, when you have this internal vibration, okay, in the same sense, you have an adjunction at the level of logic, which is given by the left adjoint here that we looked before, which is really a left adjoint, okay, of what is coming from the height adjoint, okay, of the functor F alpha. You could think really geometrically to that as a kind of hypothesis that the vibration is itself layer from layer a vibration. Okay. Now you come to language. So you have several languages. It's true, as Jean-Claude told at some moment, that we are using now language which are more close to linear logic, okay, than to traditional logic. Okay. And this is developed in our text, but now we could also just restrict to the simplest case, that the language is given by object in the topos, okay? And we are not looking exactly at the classifier for the part, but at the classifier of sub object of a given object. Okay. Practically, this is sufficient. Okay. In all application, we know, for example, we have bar in entry, and they have a color, and they have length, okay. And it's easy to construct an object of the topos where coming from the stack, okay, which express very well all of that. Okay. And what is our semantic function? So I connect now only to the dynamic, okay, is the fact that the activity of the layers, okay, express axioms of theories, okay, which are interesting to conclude at the end. Okay. So T out of C in, okay, is the name for the theory which is expected, okay, when you have the input C in. Okay. And so now, so this map in some sense, people external to the networks are able, if they will take a lot of time, so that's what they look only at samples of spot. But theoretically, human people today are able to answer if they take time. Okay. So it gives this kind of theoretical correspondence between input and theory. But the network itself, has to construct this quotient. In fact, this quotient are just given by activity of some neurons of the layer. That's why DU is for discrete at this moment. Not all the neurons are discretized, but here we look at the discretized. Okay? And these discretized neurons give part of the sub-object, okay, which are seen are different axioms, okay, for a theory. And this axiom must transport to the good theory. This is a good semantic functioning, in some sense. You could have bad semantic functioning, but it is how we relate the dynamic to the theory. And now we can vary the stack over C, because a given architecture, okay, depending on the kind of problem, okay, could use different category to construct the stack. And this was looked by Giraud, okay, when, in some sense, it is the category of stack over C, when the two categories of stack over C, when M is the category of category. Okay. But here, as you will see, it will be very interesting to generalize that, and to, because category of category in some sense is what is named a closed model category from what generalized sense, okay, but you have many categories which are interesting. In fact, for us, the most interesting at this moment is the category of groupoids. Okay. But you also can have this category, perhaps I take one word about it, made by a vibration in groupoid over Posset, okay, which is also a closed model category. Posset are closed model category too. In the sense of Quillen, okay. With good properties. Okay. But what are these categories, okay, model categories? Because they will play a role now for the rest of the talk. Okay. So not everybody, I suppose, know what they are. Okay. But they were invented by Quillen, and they were a large source of inspiration for Grothendieck, okay, in the pursuit of the stacks and his theory of derivatives, okay, which turns around this notion of closed model in another term. Okay. So Thomasson exchanged with Grothendieck, and Sisisky and Maximiotis answered any question of Grothendieck about this object. And Lurie gets the construction we needed here. Okay. And it says that, closed model category is a category with a special morphism, which look like vibration, other for vibration, and other as a homotopy equivalence. Okay. And the goal is to do homotopy in the framework of category, in particular for defining what is the homotopy category, that's the morphism of to homotopy with some special object, not all the objects. Yeah. And why the motivation of Quillen was to extend the construction coming from algebra, from topology to algebra. Okay. Like it was happened at the beginning when Hopf, for example, understood that the cohomology introduced before for topology was very useful also in group theory. Okay. And after that, it was done for algebra, for Lie algebra, and in fact, all that concerned homology. And the next step was homotopy, and it's now arriving, okay. And it was still arriving before. And so what says what the first paragraph here is that when I have this, such kind of category with homotopy, if I take so the category of contravariant functor from C to M, then I get a new model category. And very interestingly, this generates a very wide tip theory. And it's able, for example, if you use for M the category of simplicial set, to generate what is named homotopy theory of type, or Voigt-Wolski, or the kind of univalent axiom. So this kind of tip theory constitutes some extension of ordinary tip theory, including many kind of set theory and of in some sense, a kind of revision of the basis of mathematics. And Hart and Kapulkin has shown that precisely this category MC here, for example, the category of groupoid, okay, define such general tip theory, which was introduced by Martin Le. As I said, it is a wide extension, okay, of the kind of language we used before. But it is that when you vary now the stack, okay. So and the main result is that technically for what we are doing for with moduli of networks is this fact that in this special case of DNN, okay, it's not true for POSEP, then you can determine easily what are the fibration, and in particular, what has been the fibrant object, that is the object such that the map to the point, so the category, which is final category, which always exists in this setting. Okay. This fibrant object are descriptible. Okay. And we were very stuck in some sense because they correspond exactly to the condition to make that the theory are propagated in the logic or language over the stack. Yeah. And so perhaps it's too technical to describe, but we recover exactly this condition. Yeah. That in fact, we not only have vibration, but vibration made by vibration. Yeah. And it includes the case of the fork, where you see you add the projection from a product. And this projection from a product is exactly what you need here to have a vibrant object. So what is it? What is important to look at this vibrant object? It's because because here in this case, every object is also named co-fibrant. Co-fibrant, that is a map, you have a map from initial to the category, which is a co-fibration. And this is important because the homotopy category has exactly this object as an object. And this is a fibrant and co-fibrant. It is said by Quillen. And so, yeah, in some sense, we connect with homotopy, something which were interesting from the semantic point of view. So this will be the next step. Okay. now to use information, try to define semantic information. So perhaps I skip about this Katzmann point. And we look now at this language of theories, how they propagate. And we consider the set of theories, and in some sense, we can localize further to get this Katz manifold. And we can look at the subset of theory which exclude some proposition. The theory excluding proposition, and that we observe experimentally, that they play a special role in the logical activity of the cell. And this is a kind of localization. And now we construct from this language, we construct vibration over the vibration. And we can extract a kind of more precise category here, such that the theory behave well over this language. Now, this is the important formula here at the end, in the definition. Okay. And we suppose that we look at propositions which are implied in the naive sense by the proposition in this elementary logic. All is local. Yeah. Okay. You have in a layer, and you are in a certain context. Okay. And you look at the theory which is expressed in this language. Okay. And you have this interesting operation, which is given by internal implication. And the idea is that this internal implication will play the role that conditioning play in the Bayesian framework. And so first I come to this semantic information. So this was the work on Topos that Laurent reminded with Pierre Baudot. We have shown that the Shannon entropy is a universal cohomology class for a special moduli in a Ringel topos. This is a function of the probabilities. And this Ringel topos is made by a set of random variables with forgetting maps. So the maps of the category of the subset are just forgetting. Okay. Same sense, analog, there's two analogies with the network. Okay. First, you have from layer to layer a kind of forgetting. But more than that, when you look at the proposition, the internal semantic over the stack, okay, you can say that this proposition themselves, for instance, are variables okay, which have which could have value. For example, if you introduce an additional function for measuring the value of a proposition, and here you see that you have this subset of random variables. So here the ring structure okay, is the joint of variables. In our case, it is the AND or the tensor product for monoidal category. And here, the action is given by the mean of conditioning. But the conditioning gives the action. And when you look at that, in some sense, as a topological object, okay, you extract the information quantity from the cohomological invariant of this object. So it was natural in this context to decide, it is very top down now, that information must be the invariant of what we just described, because we described categories, they are this propagation of language. Okay? And over them, you have the theory. And the analogy is that theories are analog of probability. And the conditioning, which is given by the internal implication, is the analog of the probabilistic conditioning. In fact, we have not in this paper, but in another paper which will be put on archive, they make this analogy precise. And now we compute the invariant. And so at the level zero, all is okay. In some sense, we have the kind of, we describe the theoretical Katzmann rule at the level of semantics. But what is deceptive is that there is no Higher cohomology in this case. Okay? And this is mainly due to the fact that you have always a kind of equivalent of false in this theory. Okay? And by using this false or the equivalent, which is, for example, P, when you localize, okay, it's very easy to kill all the cocycles. Okay? In fact, it's something which happened also in quantum theory. You can apply the same principle to quantum information, and you compute the cohomology as before, and you see that the entropy, which is also present in quantum, because quantum always give also ordinary probability law, okay? And the fundamental entropy, in a sense, is the analog of this function psi, that it makes that the entropy becomes a problem value. Okay? But here it's worse because, in fact, we don't have justification for hash. So you have a very large ambiguity about what could be this fundamental quotient. So this function C is largely arbitrary. So we will try to make it more precise, okay, by using something like Jean-Claude spoke at the end, a kind of Galois theory, which is given by the structure of the fiber FU, for example, group of okay, and to make that this function, okay, which has some functorial property, is better characterized. In some sense, we recover when you take numerical function in the Boolean case, okay, we just recover the ambiguity that was already described by Carnap and Barillel in 1952, where they constated that, in some sense, you have an arbitrary measure, in sense, for defining the information, except some element of independency or symmetry. So perhaps things will be better when you go to homotopy. And so here we can describe an object which replaced the bar complex homotopically from the set of series, okay, and two very interesting kind of gluing in the theory. Since the gluing, they are in some sense adjoint gluing. Okay. You see, here I look at what is named homogeneous quotient in the case of the bar complex, which can be described without anything abelian. That's only the fact that if you make the action, which is given by conditioning on the theory, it must be the same as if you multiply the proposition, okay, that you want to take in account. So you have two kind of elements. You have propositional calculus, essentially coming from the output, which made by the gamma, and the theory which propagates in the network to answer the question at the output. But you have another one, okay, which in some sense is translate the dynamics, that the kind of propagation you get of the theory along the theoretical networks. And if you can define not only equivalence of that, but homotopy equivalence, that you take cylinders and you just look that you make an homotopy quotient, which is not ordinary quotient, okay? And you get something like a natural space of, in fact, it is a B, it is a simplicial space, that is a B simplicial, okay? Which looks like a good candidate to represent homotopically the theory. And now the semantic function, you can do the same, not for the proposition, but for the propagation with the network itself. with the dynamical object. And now the semantic functioning become a conjectural simplicial map, because it can be very poor, in fact. The objective is make that this map is rich. Yeah. so it is defined in some sense a kind of homotopy type of the description by the network of the problem which is to solve. And I look at the hour, so I must stop very soon. Okay. And here at this level, we could look at maps from theory to theory of space, for example, in a model theory. And it's easy to reproduce totally non-abelian framework, okay, the main relation, for example, of the information theory. For example, here you have this relation, the Shannon equation, H P to prime, and now it means that when you subtract the entropy of some theories, then you get the conditioning. And so one example we worked out was L23, this theory that Jean-Claude described. So perhaps I skip that, because he already spoke about this kind of Galois theory, just to attain at the end. Okay. Now we will vary the stack. So we are varied at this moment the stack, okay, and the language. But now we want also to vary the network, the architecture. And when we do that, we come exactly with what Grothendieck did today, okay? Especially when we enlarge groupoid category to any closed model category. So we come to this two functor from the two category of small category to larger category. And the principal example is here, that is DM of the small category Y are all the precious, okay, with value in M over E. So exactly the one which encounter with zero or for the relative purpose of Olivia. And this generalize what was done before for the derivative category in the Abelian test. And the hope of Grothendieck, and which is make concrete with the theorem of Malsignatis and CCC, is that this constitutes not only a generalization of topos. You see, it's exactly the formula for topos, for the topos of Cauchy, okay, but it generalizes all the homological algebra. And what is important is really to consider the functoriality in the small category here. And as we have shown, that in information space, they belong to such functor, okay? And we consider only vibrant objects for doing that, okay? In some sense, we are working on this on the homotopy category of this derivative. And so, just I come back to finish to concrete structure, okay? Because this kind of moduli, okay, in networks, okay, were appearing, okay, very structured. And this one, for example, which is named the attention moduli, or more generally, a transformer, okay, you see, is given by this very interesting formula, okay, to take a nonlinear map, okay, of some quadratic operation. X and Y are the input vectors, okay, and the W, WK are matrices you compute with weights. Okay, and you take something which has fundamentally a kind of degree three, okay, but which has also this form, okay, which is very important, okay, to first apply the nonlinearity to the quadratic part. And all that, all these cells, okay, are now essential for all semantic functioning in network. And what we explain in our paper, okay, is that, in some sense, this degree three, okay, is recovered at the level of neurons, okay? And you can understand this functioning, okay, as sub-networks, okay, where the internal structure of the fibers, okay, are an actin groupoid, okay, which is beyond and underlying the deformation of the gate polynomial. And it was the same for the LSTM cell or approximation of them, okay, which are named GRU. These have exactly the same form. Okay. And this is for HT. Okay. And this this form, you see, it was a plus. Okay. So this is only quadratic. The first CT is quadratic, but HT is of the three. And all deformation which work have this form. And so this is the categories that Jean-Claude showed us. Okay. So it's in some sense a tentative to understand the structure of this modulus, okay, and the way it contributes to the global function. And so this is the theorem which says that this map is not structurally stable, but on each coordinate it is. That is, in some sense, the way it contributes sufficiently many parameters, okay, to make that individually the neuron become stable. And this connects with two things. Okay. This stability connects with a theory I am happy to encounter in this context, which was the unfolding theory of Conneton, because he connected this theory of stability of unfolding to linguistics. But what is more impressive is that independently, through linguists, okay, which is Antoine Cullioli, developed such kind structure, okay, to understand the manipulation of notions in a language. And here I say the two references, okay, to the book for Cullioli, a book of Conneton. And of course, we are not working with true language. Okay. But as recently Gromov underlined, there is no theory, no mathematical theory of language. In fact, even more, it was said by Wittgenstein and Austin that we cannot speak coherently of language, because the language cannot be embedded in language, and it's endless. Okay? That the possibility of language are endless. And but we encounter them, okay, and we can develop coherent mathematical language for some kind of artificial language, which are not the ordinary language. So sorry, I'll stop here.
Okay, so thank you so much, Daniel.